Hi everyone, my name is Alex. I'm one of the MCAT tutors at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. And today I'm going to go through a biology passage with you. We'll go a little bit more in depth than you would normally go on the actual MCAT, so we can kind of break down the strategies and then also break down some of the content. Okay. Let's go ahead and break this thing down. So let's start with the first paragraph. The pituitary gland works closely with the hypothalamus to regulate homeostasis, metabolism, reproduction, and growth in multiple target organs. The pituitary gland is separated into the adenohypophysis and narrow hypophysis, known as the anterior and posterior lobes, respectively. The anterior pituitary secretes five distinct types of hormones: somatotropes, lactotropes, thyrotropes, corticotropes, and gonadotropes. Okay, I'm just kind of mentally noting that they told us what these different things are, the adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis, and those are the anterior and posterior lobes of the pituitary, which I should be relatively familiar with for the MCAT. And then they're talking about these different hormones here, so if they end up asking questions about that, I'll know where to go back to. Pituitary organogenesis and hormone synthesis is a complex process that is not completely understood. Okay. Many different transcription factors are temporally and spatially regulated. PIT1, for example, is required for pituitary cell differentiation. And the PIT1 gene has been implicated in GH, TSH, and prolactin deficiency. Okay, I'm just going to underline PIT here so I know if they end up asking me questions about PIT, I can come back to that. In a recent study, scientists have discovered transcription factor ZBTB20 that could play a key role in anterior pituitary development and lactotrope specification in mice. Z is a zinc finger protein that contains BTB, POZ domains, and C2H2 cupel type zinc fingers. Now, something I always like to stress with the MCAT is that I will throw these kind of crazy genes, like these crazy names for genes at you. Don't let that intimidate you. Just know it's another variable we have to be aware of. Sometimes they'll throw these crazy names just to try to scare you, but don't let it scare you. To further characterize the role of Z in the anterior pituitary development, scientists performed a knockout experiment in mice. Z global knockout mice were bred and their phenotypes characterized. Hypopituitarism was found to be a result of Z knockout. Further results of this study are presented in figure 1. All right, we got this figure here, and I do like to break figures down. And the method I like to use for that is this little mnemonic here, T-A-I-D-P. T standing for title, A standing for axis, I for the independent variable, D for the dependent variable, and then P for patterns. So what patterns I see. So let's go ahead and do that with this figure here. This figure, normally, or sometimes there will be a title for the figure. The title here is just figure 1. So we can't really read the title and get information from that, but I do recommend reading the title for every figure, because there is sometimes a lot of information in those titles that is surprisingly helpful to be able to answer questions. So no real title here. Axes, on the x-axis we have age in weeks, and then y-axis we've got body weight. The independent variable being whether or not these mice were had the ZBTB20 gene. So these are normal. This plus plus means that they have the gene, and then knockout. So these were our knockout mice. And the dependent variable being their body weight at different times in weeks. And what patterns do I see? Well, I see for both of these mice, the ones that do have the gene and the knockouts, they initially have an increase in body weight over time, but the knockout mice end up gaining less body weight, and in fact even have what looks like a little bit of a decrease in body weight between week 3 and week 4, whereas the mice that do have the normal gene continue to grow over time, from between week 0 and all the way through to week 4, continuing to increase in weight. So that's the patterns I see from this figure. Let's continue with the rest of the passage. Researchers followed the mice throughout their lifespan. At postnatal day 21, or P21, scientists performed ELISA experiments to analyze anterior pituitary hormonal contents in both wild type and knockout mice. The results are presented in figure 2. All right, so let's do the same thing that we did with the previous figure to break down this figure. And title here, looks like the title really is just giving us the name, what the different abbreviations stand for, like GH stands for growth hormone, PRL standing for prolactin. So it's just the abbreviations for what the hormones stand for. Axes, we have whether or not these mice are the ones that have the gene or are the knockouts. That's on our x-axis. And then the y-axis is the amount of these particular hormones in nanograms per pituitary. So x-axis being whether or not they have the gene, and then y-axis being the amount of hormone that they produced. Independent variable again being whether or not these are the normal or the knockout mice, and then the dependent variable being the amount of hormone produced. And what patterns do we see? We do see this star means a statistically significant decrease in this hormone here, growth hormone. Prolactin also even more statistically significant decrease in prolactin. TSH, no real change here. ACTH, also no statistically significant change. And then luteinizing hormone, no change either. Okay, so we've broken down both figures, and we know where to go if they end up asking us questions about these adeno hypotheses or neuro hypothesis. So let's start with the questions. Question one, suppose a patient presents unregulated oversecretion of thyrotropes from the anterior pituitary. Which of the following symptoms is this patient most likely to experience? Well, let's see, what's a thyrotrope? Thyrotrope right here, they said was TSH. TSH. So TSH stands for thyroid stimulating hormone. And sometimes these hormone names are friendly, and they tell you what they actually do. You can't always count on that, but in this case, they're being friendly and they're telling us what they're doing. This is a thyroid stimulating hormone, meaning that it actually stimulates the thyroid. So if we stimulate the thyroid, that's what TSH is going to do. If TSH comes in, TSH is going to go to the thyroid gland and stimulate the thyroid gland. Now, what's it going to stimulate the thyroid gland to do? It's going to stimulate the thyroid gland to release thyroid hormones, which are our T4 and our T3. Now, what do T4 and T3 regulate in a word? In a word, they regulate metabolism. So if you're going to have more too much T4 and T3, you're going to have what's called hyperthyroidism. Your metabolism will be moving too fast. Likewise, if you have too little of it, you'll have hypothyroidism. Your metabolism will be moving too slow. So we're going to be looking for answers that indicate somebody that is having a metabolism that is overactive. So let's look through the possible answers. And see if any of them are in line with a person that would be having an overactive metabolism. So let's see. Answer A, weight loss. Well, straight off the bat, that looks like a good answer to me. So I'm going to leave that for now. Vasodilation of heart and lungs. Maybe, but that sounds more like a sympathetic nervous system kind of thing to me rather than this kind of general regulation of metabolism. So I'm thinking not for that one. Increased sex hormone levels. Now, I think this would probably be more something that the gonadotropes would do, the FSH and the LH, not something necessarily being regulated by these hormones that are really responsible for regulating our metabolic rate. So I'm thinking not that one either. And then gigantism. Gigantism is when a person grows to the level of grows more than they should. And the hormone that's generally implicated for that is our growth hormone, not the TSH or the T4 or T3. So I'm going to cross gigantism off, and that very first answer, weight loss, looks pretty good to me. So we're going to choose A for this one. Question two. Abnormal levels of which hormone most likely explain the results shown in figure one? Okay, so figure one over here, we broke this down. We saw that there was a decrease in growth between, I think it looks like it's starting around week two. They really start to the knockout mice really start to diverge from the normal mice. And how are they changing? They're changing in their body weight, so they're not growing as much. So something is wrong with these mice and their growth. So let's look through the different possible answers and see if any of them have to do with growth. First one, ACTH. Now, ACTH, that's the hormone that goes to your adrenal cortex and causes the release of corticosteroids, aka cortisol. And cortisol has some effect on metabolism of certain macromolecules in our body, but it's not really super linked with something like something that would happen here, where we're having a decrease in body weight. I'll leave it for now because cortisol can have some changes on our body composition. But it's not my fa it's not a great answer, so I'm going to leave that as a possibility, but we'll come back to it. B, prolactin. Prolactin. What's prolactin mostly involved in? Well, for the MCAT, we got to with prolactin, we got to think of milk production, lactation for mothers, for breastfeeding, for infants. That's primarily what prolactin's involved in. And did we see any? Was there anything about lactation here on this figure? No. So I'm thinking B is probably not such a good answer. TSH, well, we addressed the TSH issue up in question one. TSH is involved with metabolism, not really involved with growth. So I'm going to cross that one off. And then D, HGH, human, or that's growth hormone. Now, if we're torn between ACTH, which causes an increase in cortisol, which can change body composition, and another hormone called growth hormone. Well, I'm going to go with growth hormone. That's definitely the better answer here. Growth hormone is the most likely explanation for this change in growth that happened in these mice. So ACTH, not nearly as good of an answer as growth hormone here. Question three, which of the following hormones are secreted by the neurohypothesis? Okay, so what is the neurohypothesis? Well, they tell us over here that the adenohypothesis is the anterior pituitary and the neurohypothesis is the posterior pituitary. And we are responsible to know the hormones that are released from the anterior and the posterior lobes of the pituitary. Now, from the neurohypothesis, which is the posterior pituitary, the two hormones that are released from there are ADH, aka antidiuretic hormone, also known as vasopressin, and then oxytocin. So we're just looking for one of those two. Epinephrine, nope, that one comes from the adrenal medulla. Oxytocin, looks good to me. Progesterone, no, that comes from either the adrenal cortex or the ovaries. For the MCAT, mostly you got to think ovaries for progesterone, so not from the posterior pituitary. And then aldosterone, also from the adrenal cortex. That's not our answer here, so it's going to be oxytocin. This one was as simple as trying to figure out what the neurohypothesis is, and then remembering which hormones come from that area. Question four, which of the following conclusions can be drawn from figure two? Okay, well, we did our breakdown on figure two over here. Let's go ahead and take a look through the answers and see which ones might line up. Z knockout leads to decreased production in all hormones from the anterior pituitary. Well, we know that's not true because here, here, and here, there was no statistically significant change. So we can cross A off for that. Z knockout has little to no effect on mice. That is also not true because if we look at what's going on here, there is definitely a statistically significant change. So that is not true. C, Z knockout leads to severe defect of lactotropes. Now this one's starting to look good because they said the lactotropes were PRL, aka prolactin. And we do see a significant decrease here in prolactin secretion in knockout mice. So I'm going to leave C for now. Let's check D. Z is necessary for anterior pituitary organogenesis. Now that is not really relevant to what we're seeing here in the figure. Organogenesis would be the growth of that organ, and the organ does exist because there is the secretion of some hormones like LH, ACTH, TSH, and even prolactin and growth hormone, although they're in smaller amounts. So we don't have enough information here to really be able to say that Z is necessary for the organogenesis of the anterior pituitary. The data that we have is not extensive enough to be able to allow us to make that conclusion, but we can make the conclusion of C, that this gene knockout leads to severe defect in lactotropes, as we see over here. In fact, it's it looks like the most severe, most statistically significant decrease in prolactin secretion in these knockout mice. If you liked this walkthrough, be sure to like the video and then subscribe to our channel. Also, be sure to check out our MCAT 528 series and click the link in the description to get access to more practice problems so you can get as much practice in before test day. Happy studying!